Welcome to the fourth video in a series designed to provide guidance in using SRH2D for sediment transport modeling. In this video, we will discuss executing a sediment model and potential ways to review results.
Lesson topics will include the steps involved in executing a model, an introduction to the new output parameters generated during a sediment run, finally, an initial approach to reviewing the results to ensure the output will serve the analysis task.
Once all of the components necessary for a sediment model are prepared, the user is ready to create and execute a simulation and review the results. A simulation can be started from scratch by right-clicking in the Table of Contents pane, selecting New Simulation, and then the SRH2D model type. Be sure to give the simulation a meaningful name. The mesh, boundary conditions, material roughness layer, sediment material layer, and any monitor coverages can be added to the simulation by selecting each component, right-clicking, and adding to the simulation. Then, open the model control window to fill out the fields as you would for a hydraulic model, with user-assigned descriptions, case name, start time, time step, and end time. SRH2D is a robust model that does not usually require time steps of less than 1 second for stable, accurate results for most applications. During the development of a model, the emphasis is to ensure the model components are well-formed and correct, and it is recommended to start with a time step between 1 and 5 seconds. As the model is refined and analysis progresses, the time step may be further refined. Model end times will vary by the needs of the analysis, and the user should expect to need to execute a sediment model for much longer than a comparable hydraulic model. Where a hydraulic model may achieve a stable, steady condition in just an hour or two of modeled time, a sediment model may take tens or hundreds of hours to achieve results that are useful for analysis. One of the main reasons for this is because there is likely to be some difference between the topography of the channel bed in the initial mesh and the topography that would develop during the modeled condition. The initial condition for a sediment model should be a stable, steady-state result from the same model previously run as a hydraulic-only model, referred to as a restart file. The other available options, dry, initial water surface elevation, automatic, or water surface elevation dataset, may introduce unwanted startup effects that influence the full model results. An exception to this is if the user elects to use the Sediment Start Time feature from the Sediment tab. With this option, where the user specifies the number of hours the simulation is to run in hydraulics-only mode, any of the initial condition options are available. Continue to fill out the necessary details to define your sediment run. The viewer is referred to the previous video for guidance with these details. Once complete, save and run the simulation. And when the simulation is complete, load the results. Output results for each element include the 6 parameters from hydraulic modeling: shear stress, Froude number, velocity, magnitude and direction, water depth, and water surface elevation, plus 4 additional ones: bed elevation, concentration, D50, and relative erosion and deposition. Bed elevation reflects the absolute elevation through time. Concentration reflects the total load of sediment in transport at that element in parts per million. For concentrations of sediment normally seen in a river channel, less than about 65,000 parts per million, the mass units parts per million are interchangeable with the volumetric units milligrams per liter. This exchange allows a concentration to be converted along with a unit discharge to a value with the units of tons per day, which is a unit of measure commonly used when discussing sediment transport. For more information on transport rate units and conversions, the viewer is referred to FHWA's HEC 16 manual. D50 is the median grain size of the active layer of sediment. Generally, as erosion occurs, finer sediment is eroded faster than coarse sediment, and the D50 is expected to increase. When deposition occurs, more fine sediment is deposited than coarse sediment, and so the D50 decreases. Erosion deposition reflects the amount of bed change from the initial condition. Positive values represent erosion, and negative values represent deposition. The erosion deposition value is the exact value of the bed elevation at time zero minus the bed elevation at the computational time step. When reviewing results, the user should first ensure the model completed without any issues. One way to do that is to right-click on one of the output parameters and select the properties window. Check that the ending time matches the expected duration. Then scroll through the water surface elevation results looking for signs of instability. SRH2D is a robust model and can tolerate some amount of instability without crashing. However, in order to ensure confidence in the results, any unexpected oscillations in the water surface elevation should be addressed. In this case, reducing the time step eliminates the observed oscillations. Always be sure the simulation is saved before running to ensure the new model parameters are captured. After you are satisfied that no instability exists, review the erosion results. To start, you can check the properties of the erosion deposition results and check if the erosion results reach the maximum amount as prescribed in the sediment materials coverage. In this case, the model reports the point of maximum erosion achieved during the simulation was approximately 21 feet. Reviewing the results spatially shows the maximum occurs at and just downstream of the bridge opening. Highlighting the sediment materials coverage and double-clicking on a coverage polygon brings up the sediment materials property window. Reviewing the properties shows that the total amount of allowable erosion in the channel is 21 feet, the reported maximum. If the modeler knows that this total depth is appropriate, perhaps because of a bedrock layer, then it may be appropriate to leave these parameters unchanged and know that the maximum erosion depth has been reached. More frequently, the total depth is unknown, and when this is the case, the bottom layer thickness should be increased to ensure it does not restrict the erosion results. Save and rerun the simulation with the updated materials property. And inspect the results. As the maximum erosion has increased to over 25 feet, the modeler is assured that it has not been constrained by the material properties. Next, inspect the bed elevation values throughout the run period. This is essentially the same information as the erosion deposition parameter, but presented in a manner that is more intuitive. Some irregular erosion and/or deposition at the inlet boundary is expected and does not imply that the rest of the model results are unusable. Review the results for any unexpected geomorphic effect. In this case, the channel upstream of the bridge has almost entirely filled with sediment. Again, if the modeler has insight indicating this behavior is expected, there may not be a need to change anything. However, more than likely, this indicates an input sediment load that is too high. In this case, distribution of flow at the inlet was based on the conveyance-weighted approach, which results in very high velocities in the channel that drive the capacity approach to calculating the sediment input. Switching to the constant velocity approach more accurately represents the overall hydraulic behavior of the system during a high flow event, and will reduce the sediment load.
A more detailed discussion of this can be found in a previous video.
With the appropriate parameters specified, the user can save and run the simulation. Then load the results once complete and confirm the results have improved. In this case, the previously observed filling of the channel no longer occurs. If the run was for a single constant discharge, you will want to gauge if the runtime was long enough to achieve a steady state. For an analysis that focuses on erosion in a specific location, placing an observation point at the scour point and generating a time series plot should provide insight into whether or not the maximum scour had occurred. From the plot wizard, select the bed elevation output for the entire simulation run. The shape of this plot suggests that while the rate of erosion slows with time, that after 50 simulation hours, the total erosion has not yet begun to level off. It is not uncommon for a constant discharge run to require several hundred simulation hours to achieve a steady or near steady state. In this case, the runtime was increased to 500 hours. Save and run the simulation. Load the results once complete. Review the bed elevation results for unexpected effects. And then review the time series results for the monitor point. This plot shows that after the additional 450 hours, the model more than doubled the total erosion at the plotted location, which is likely valuable for the analysis task. It also shows that the erosion does not appear to have leveled off by the end of the simulation. It may be that a fully unchanging steady-state result is not achieved, which is not uncommon and does not indicate the results are not useful. Ultimately, it is up to the modeler to consider the ultimate goal of the analysis task and use judgment to determine when the model has yielded useful results. This concludes the video on executing and reviewing a sediment transport model. The topics covered included the steps involved in executing a model, including guidelines for time step and initial conditions, an introduction to the new output parameters generated during a sediment run, including a discussion of converting concentrations to tons per day, and finally, an initial approach to reviewing the results, including how to ensure the model completed without instabilities or overly constrained erosion limits, and assessing whether or not a steady solution was achieved. In the next video, we will cover sensitivity testing and other analysis approaches.
For more information on additional videos, documents, and other reference material about two-dimensional modeling in SMS, please navigate to the link provided here.